My name is Yo. I'm the president of the Nikkei Student Union at UC San Diego.
I'm Ed Kobayashi. I'm currently a member of UCLA Nikkei Student Union. I was banging around on the taiko drums earlier, if anyone saw.
Okay. I think this is the first time we've done this at Manzanar After Dark. But tonight we're going to have three speakers give short 10-minute speeches about their experiences as internees. The first one is actually Joyce Okazaki.
She was a former Manzanar internee. I believe she was here when she was 6 years old. And there's actually a book called Born Free and Equal, and she's on the cover. And she'll be our first speaker tonight.
When he got home, FBI were waiting on the doorstep and they arrested him. And of course, we were all shocked. We didn't know why. So he was taken to jail and eventually taken to Missoula, Montana. That left my grandmother alone with her children, who were mostly grown. I had an aunt who was still in high school. One of her daughters was a doctor and married to another doctor, and they were asked to go to Manzanar to start the hospital. So my grandmother decided she wanted to stay with the family, and they signed up to go to Manzanar. And since we wanted to also join our family, my parents signed up to go early, and we left on April 2nd to go to Manzanar in 1942. Waiting for the train, we were like standing at the side of a railroad track, and I often wondered for a long time why we were not allowed to go to a train station, but we were right there just in the tracks, and then we were boarded, and of course there were soldiers patrolling the area. When we got to camp, it was dark. I can't remember exactly how this happened, but I know we were on Army transport trucks, and when we got off the trucks, my uncle met us at started to lead us to where we were supposed to live, and he told us, "Watch out for the ditches," because they dug ditches all over. And as he was telling us that, he fell into a ditch. So we all kind of laughed. He didn't break anything, though. Anyway, that was life. I think a lot of you have heard that we had cots, and we had cotton bags, which we filled with straw. A lot of that has been told. For me, I didn't really know. You know, I wasn't feeling anything because I was with my parents. I was young. I was in second grade. And I didn't know where I was. I didn't know what was going to happen. And I'm sure that my parents were probably equally concerned because I don't think they were told what was going to happen or how long they were going to stay in Manzanar. My father graduated from UC Berkeley as an architect. He couldn't get a job because they didn't hire Japanese at that time as internees in architectural firms. So he just worked in the San Lorenzo nursery at the beginning, and later on worked with my grandfather in the dry goods store. My mother graduated from USC as a physical education major, and in the early 30s, or when she was about to be a student teacher, they did not hire, the LA City did not hire Japanese. I think they changed their policy a little later on. So she also did not become credentialed. Then when we went to Manzanar, my father worked for the Public Works Department. And they're the ones that drew up plans for the gymnasium and that sort of thing, different works projects throughout the camp. And my mother was a PE teacher from 1943 to 44, and she taught from 7th to 12th grade, boys and girls. It was kind of rough for her, because she was like 5 feet tall, and she had to teach senior boys, and they weren't always the nicest students. And let's see, for me, school didn't start right away. It didn't start until the fall of 1942. And so at that time, then I went to third grade. People often ask me, well, was there a music program for elementary level? I remember that there was a pageant that we put on in the spring, and they rehearsed us, and we got to sing, learn to sing all kinds of songs and chorus, and we learned dances. So, you know, we had somewhat of an education. It probably was not as good as if we were going to a regular public school. But some of the teachers were very conscientious. As I grew up, as time passed, Ansel Adams came to Manzanar to take photographs. And our family was selected to be photographed by him. And he wrote this book. It wasn't like this. This is a reprint. But in 1944, he published it as a sort of a magazine type of a book. And it wasn't well received. A lot of people had the prejudice against Japanese. And so he was very upset about it, and I think a lot of the books were confiscated from the shelves. But he took a picture of my family, and in it we have my mother, my father, my sister, and me. Let me show you. Oh, here. That's me, and that's my sister. And this is the mother that was a PE teacher, right there. And that was a really nice, very fun experience for me, because subsequently, our photographs were put into art galleries, and there was all kinds of exhibits and showings. I was asked a question about prejudice. At age 7 and 8, you really don't know too much about prejudice. You know, you don't feel it. But I did feel it when I was about 12 years old. I came back from Chicago to Los Angeles for a visit, and my grandmother told me, there are people walking down the street who are not very nice, especially some of these women. They will come and hit you with their elbow in the head. And of course, I didn't believe it, because I was 12. You know, you don't think of those things. And by golly, we were walking down Hill Street in Los Angeles, right by the Bullock's department store, and some lady came and jabbed me in the head. And of course, I screamed, because it was such a shock. But that was the kind of prejudice that I encountered here. Now, when we moved from Manzanar to Chicago during camp, it was 1944. And when I moved to Chicago, people were very, very friendly. There was very little outward prejudice. They accepted me for what I was. And the students really hadn't seen a Japanese American, but they didn't question it. They became my friends. And so I didn't have any problems with prejudice. And I doubt that my parents did either in Chicago. So we didn't face the same kind of thing that happened to many families when the war ended and the camps were closed and they had to move back to their former homes or former hometowns. I heard it was really very devastating. Sometimes they had to live in those trailer camps. Sometimes they were put up in Buddhist temples. Many of them were like homeless. So it was a very tragic time.
Thanks so much, Joyce. Next up, we have Wilbur Sato, who is another former internee at Manzanar, at the Children's Village, which is an orphanage. And Manzanar was the only internment camp that actually had an orphanage. So here's Wilbur Sato.
Thank you. I was called about a day before we left for Manzanar to come and speak to you about my personal experiences. So bear with me. I will turn 80 tomorrow.
Wow.
Somebody told me that, you know, since you were 12 years old in 1941 and 42, that you weren't affected by this camp experience, by being interned. You must have been a happy-go-lucky person and have no ill effects on this about this camp experience. But I'm here to tell you that's not true at all. All of us have a sense of that sense of pride and security in our own person. And for instance, we have our own space. And if people violate that space, if you're attacked, assaulted, or raped, or you're robbed, or something like that, it's a profound experience that's very deeply hurting. It hurt very much. And the same thing with the psychological damage. We also have the thing about ourselves and our personality. And we grow up with that. And all of us are Americans. And during the 1941, we were part of that optimism and enthusiasm and support of America. We wore V for Victory pins on our clothes, you know, and we were very patriotic, and we were rooting for America, and we loved America. And that was part of our being, our personality. And what happens when you're humiliated and you are people call you a saboteur and traitor and a spy and all that kind of stuff. It goes to your very sense of being. It's very hurtful. And I can tell you that affected me for many, many years. When we went to camp, it was very depressing. You know, we were kicked out of Terminal Island, lived in Terminal Island. They gave us 24 hours and then 48 hours to leave. So we had to leave in the middle of the night, you know, without saying goodbye to our friends and neighbors. And then that was towards the end of February of 1942. And then near the end of March, we were given a 1 week's notice. They were said, you're going to be evacuated. It's quote, evacuated. We didn't know where we were going and how long we were going to stay and what was going to happen to us. And we were off again, you know, and this was we were going to go to Manzanar. So we went to the railroad station. We were met by soldiers in full battle dress. They had helmets and rifles with bayonets and sidearms. And they had us pin identification tags on our clothes and our luggage, and we could only take what we could carry. And they herded us into the train. And they kept all of the shutters down. We couldn't see out. It was dark inside. They gave us a box lunch of a peanut butter sandwich and an orange. We were on that train from 7 o'clock in the morning till close to sundown. We didn't arrive to Manzanar until about the time the sun was going down. That must have been 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. April 1st, April 2nd of 1942. And people on that train, I can tell you, were angry and upset. Babies were crying. People didn't know what was going to happen to them. We came to Manzanar. We had to, before we got to into the gate, they had to examine our luggage to see if we were carrying any guns and things like that. And then we were, then the gates closed on us, and we were taken to, they were told us to fill up this tick of a straw, and then we were told to go to a certain barrack. And we went to this barrack that was dusty and dark and dirty, and with one single light bulb hanging for the ceiling, and that was our home. And I can tell you that we were depressed. We were not fit to be Americans. In fact, we lost our citizenship in a sense. We were told that our whole upbringing, who we were, you know, we were Americans, and our whole history was devalued. We were nothing. We were now the enemy. And on top of that, the Japanese language was the wrong language. The Japanese people were enemy people. You weren't supposed to speak Japanese in the meetings. You couldn't be an officer in the camp unless you were a citizen. So everything, you were devalued as an American, you were devalued as a Japanese American. And so this was very depressing. I remember we lived in Block 9, and somehow I got into the Boy Scouts, and I had a bugle, and I would go out into the middle of the fire break, and I would recite things that I knew. You know, my country 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, that kind of stuff, oh beautiful. All the things that were part of growing up. For instance, you know, and by the root bridge that arcs the flood, the flag to April's flags unfurled, April breeze unfurled. Here the embattled farmer stood and fired the shot around the world. The world will little note, no long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather that we be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. See, this was the America that we remembered and that we were part of, but now we were being excluded. So after the war, when all this was over, the question is, how do we get back to that same feeling of being an American, of being part of the community? And it took many, many years to do that and to struggle for that. I became engaged in all kinds of activities, in urging the JSL to have politicians come and speak, and to have the JSL question the politicians, to get involved in the role of government, to organize the Democratic Club. We started participating in political action. We were fighting for fair employment practices. We were fighting for fair housing practices. We were fighting for, civil rights of all sorts. And in recent times, we're fighting for the civil rights of Muslims. You know, we had candlelight vigils when 9/11 happened, and we had programs with the Buddhist and the Muslim groups. And we started to support them, and we spoke at the mosque. I spoke at the mosque in Hawthorne. And we supported gay rights and the right of gay people to marry and to have the rights of inheritance and things like that. Okay. So, in a sense, the people who went to camp, they suffered a lot of not just of property and wealth, but the sense of their psychic person. But that wasn't the greatest loss that we've suffered from this camp experience. The greatest loss was our constitution. Our constitution was diminished. The case of Korematsu, in which the government said that the executive can put us in a prison without trial, without charges, indefinitely. That case is still on the books. That's still the law. And recently, there were a number of memos that came out, were released recently, that showed that we can, the opinions were that we could torture, even though it was against our law and international law. It said that the army could go into your home and search it without search and seizures, without court order. It said that they could arrest you and hold you. These were all opinions that were generated by the Bush administration. And so we're not out of the woods. We were the Japanese American people, in a sense, were the canary in the coal mine. Democracy is still in danger. And we should have pride in our own history, all of us, and in our own sense of values, and not let those who would take away our rights have a chance to do so. Thank you.
We're sorry that we're kind of rushing the schedule through, but we have to get through the program before the buses leave tonight. And just, we really want to make sure that in the small discussion groups that follow after this, that we get to listen to more of the stories by all the former teachers. And with that, I'm going to be introducing our third speaker tonight. His name is Susumu Yenokida. He's from Galt, California, and he was a draft resistor at Amachi.
My name is Susumu Yenokida, born 1925, June the 28th, and I just retired last December. During the period when we were raised in Merced County, we all went to English school. My English was so good that the teacher can't understand me. So she asked me to stay after school every day till in the eighth grade so I could at least graduate. Then I did. However, going back to why I did resist, I am a resistor out of Amachi, Colorado. January 26, 1944. My brother, at that time, when we were in Cortez in Merced County, he was taking a course in aeronautical engineering in Modesto Junior College. At that time, when he was attending school, the administration asked him to come into the administration office and asked him if he was Japanese. Why, certainly I'm Japanese. You're taking aeronautical engineering? Yes, I am. Well, you can take any other subject, but no aeronautical engineering. And my brother asked him why. They said that if you graduate and have all the knowledge about aeronautical engineering, you're going to take that knowledge and sell it to Japan. And my brother got so angry, he told him, why should I do that? I'm born here, raised here. Why should I do something to deny what rights that I have here in the United States? Then, January 10, 1942, my dad passed away right after Pearl Harbor. In order for Dad to have a funeral, my brother had to go to the local provost marshal office and get many, many permits, like traveling permits beyond 5 miles, curfew beyond 10 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning, and gathering. Gathering was only 5 persons per gathering. We had to have permit for that. So, Dad was able to get a funeral at that time. Then, shortly after, we were sent into Merced Assembly Center. In Merced Assembly Center, we were guides in the camp because we were told that we were Boy Scouts, we gotta do our duty. So we guided people in the camps that were coming into camps. Some of the people that we did not know, some of them had to spend the night in a cold night in a bare barracks, sleeping between the blankets, I mean the mattresses, there were no blankets. So that's the story I have about days that we were in Amache, Colorado. During the time when I was in Colorado and in Amache, we did attend some meetings about draft resistors or whether to go to the Army. I went to one meeting and I figured, well, I gotta make up my own mind. So on question 27 and 28, I answered, yes, yes. But when the time came to go to the Army, and I didn't go because I figured, well, why should I go? Why should I go since I'm in the camps? Why should I go because they've taken all my rights away? So I did not go. The marshal came and then picked us up on January 26, 1944. From there, we couldn't make it to Denver in one shot because it was too far, so we spent a night in Pueblo, Colorado, in the county jail there. After going into Denver, I thought we were going to go to the county jail there, but they put us into what they call Inglewood Correctional Institute for hard criminals. And there was 5 of us at that time, and later 3 more came. And we were there 3 months before any trial, before anybody showed up. Minya Sui and Grant Noda came and told us that if we decide to go to the army, all your penalties would be written off. So we said, well, I've already made up my mind, why should I change it now? Three friends of mine told them to go to hell in Japanese. And then they were sent to a dungeon, and the temperature in that dungeon was about maybe 100 degrees, because they really make you sweat it out. If they had to stay in there any more longer than 24 hours, I think they would have went to the army. However, two of them decided to go into the army, and a year later, we got word that they had perished in war. From that time on, let's see, that was 6 months, no, 3 months in Correctional Institute, 3 months in Denver, Colorado, 1448 Klamath Street, we had a trial. And Judge Sims was our was our judge. At that time, we had written up a lot of things about civil rights and everything, but then the judge says, this is not about civil rights. It is about you people not going to the army. So we were sentenced from 6 months to maximum of 5 years. Few of the people had 6 months. They got out early. They came back and they were able to get into camp, Amachi Relocation Center. And the third person was my friend Joe Norikane. And they couldn't find him because he had slept with his sister-in-law's place besides his mother's place. So he's walking out down the street going to the outbound office there. Mr. Tomlinson says, hey, I'll give you a ride. I says, no, I walked in here, I'm walking out. And shortly later, we came, my brother, myself, and Mr. Taguma. Well, we couldn't get into camp. We couldn't get in to see the mother or father, our brothers or sisters. So every night for 10 days, we snuck into camp at night. And finally, some jealous person burned us out. We had no place to go. So Mr. Masanaga says, the best thing for you to do is go to Denver, see if you can't find work there. And we did. Mr. Masanaga loaned us probably about $300. At that time, it was big money. And we went to Denver, and being hungry, being lonely, didn't have any place to go, maybe sleep on the corner of the building or something. At that time, started working in construction and also in the sugar beet fields in Colorado. Well, he knew some people over there, so we went to help them out. And for 10 days, we worked for $33.33. My brother got so angry, we couldn't find him anymore for 4 days. And he had found a cowboy, a Japanese cowboy, that was, he had served his army term, and he was roaming around in the Denver area. And we went to Laramie, Wyoming. Oh, what a place that.